Artists from 2 to 102, amateur or professional, are invited to submit visual art pieces to the third annual Ode to Sitka Visual Art Show, sponsored by the Sitka Arty Gras and the Greater Sitka Arts Council. The Ode to Sitka celebrates life in Sitka and asks that your art pieces reflect your relationship with our town and its unique environment. The show is an exhibition only and items may not be for sale. Artists should bring their work ready to be hung or displayed to the exhibit room in Harrigan on Thursday, March 14th from 2 to 5 p.m. For more info, 747-4821.
Good morning and welcome to Sitka Sports. I am your host, Mike Vieira, and I am joined in the studio today by two special guests. It's Region 5 Basketball Tournament Week here in Sitka, and I've got two gentlemen who I grew up just loving to hate, I think is the best way to put it, people that inspired me to compete, and I've got the current head coach of the Juneau Douglas Crimson Bears men's basketball program, Robert Casperson, and the former longtime head coach, Coach George Houston, in the studio. Thanks, guys, for joining me today.
Thank you very much for having us.
No problem.
Excited to have you. And like I said, I grew up, I think my first memory really of zoning in on basketball was seventh grade Region 5 tournament here in Sitka, 1992, when the Wolves, Chad McGraw and Galen Pearson and Keith Karpstein and those guys upset the Crimson Bears, and just remember that inspiring me to want to be like them. And I think Coach Houston, you were an assistant that year, and then mm-hmm. you took over the next year, is that correct?
Yeah, I took over 92, 93 was my first year as a head coach after being the assistant for 18 years.
And Coach Casperson, he was kind of a rival of mine. We were both kind of played the same role on our teams, defensive-minded guards who mm-hmm. came off the bench and kind of ran the show, and we both very competitive, butted heads, starting in Coach Hamey's camp, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Early on in our careers and carried on. Always fun to play against each other, and we've been able to coach against each other too as we've gotten older. So, fun to have you guys in. Little known fact is I actually played two games under Coach Houston. You're looking at me like you don't remember that, but
I'm getting to that age where that comes into play.
After our senior year, Coach Bisson put on the Southeast Senior All-Star Game and brought over the winners of the 3A and 4A division that year, and you were the 4A winner. And coached, I think you got coached against Coach Brock that year. He had won the 3A, and that was fun. Played two games and had all the seniors from around Southeast together. And
that was a good experience, as I recall it. And everything that went on that time.
Yeah, we just got together for a weekend, and I'm sure it was really expensive now that I think about putting that on right after basketball season. I don't know who would have taken that on, but that was a great memory that I had, and it was fun to play for you after competing against you for so long. So the first question that I have to ask, and I didn't tell you about this before the show, so is during introductions when you were coaching, and they're introducing the visiting team, you always had something to tell your players while we were being introduced. And you could never shake Coach Houston's hand when you came out of introductions. What was going on during that time?
That was, I think it goes back to when I was in high school, and Coach Claire Markey was my high school coach. And, we were always taught to compete like crazy against whoever we're playing, and at the end of the game, then you shake your opponent's hands. And before the game, the last thing I wanted to do was shake my opponent's hand. I wanted to do it after the game.
Right.
And that was just kind of the upbringing that I had. And I know it's tradition now, but I was way before old school became old school, and I didn't do it. So just one of the quirks of coaching.
Yeah, no, it's gamesmanship.
Well, and I distinctly remember one of the catch can players one year forcing his way through the huddle. He went blazing right past the assistant coaches and forced his way through the huddle to get to Coach Houston.
We had a little discussion about that afterwards. Yeah. like it better not ever happen again.
Yeah.
I remember that there's this one little old lady who always came to our games who just always tweaked her that the Juneau coach would never shake your hands. And there was always a discussion for us before the game as to whether or not, you know, you're going to shake hands. And a lot of peer pressure that you weren't going to cross that line and go over there. I look back on it with very fond memories now, though.
Yeah, and you know, it's competition, and when you're going out there to compete, it's not all peaches and cream. And the way I was brought up is, you compete like crazy against your opponent, and then at the end of the game, win, lose, or draw, you shake hands, and you show your respect for each other then. And that's, like I say, just the way it was brought up to me, and right, wrong, or indifferent, it's just the way I chose to do it.
Yeah, and I think it created... It created a fun environment. Everyone was ready to go to battle there right off from the start. So
I'm glad I was able to fire up the other team.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. That was part of
it. And the little old ladies.
That was part of the deal. You didn't know about the ladies.
Yeah.
So your start of your coaching career kind of coincided with the beginning of both mine and Robert's playing careers. Robert was a year ahead of me, and my senior year, we had struggled against you all year. I think I had one victory against Juneau Douglas. We had won a JV game over here. For some reason, we had played it over at Mount Edgecombe. It was like during my sophomore year, and I think we had won by 1 point. And other than that, we were 0-for going into my senior year. And we had developed a pretty good player, Ryan Lane, who was a senior that year, who ended up averaging about, I think, close to 30 points a game that year. He was our team. And we had split here the first time we played you guys. Two close games. I remember very hotly contested games. I remember those clearly because I wasn't starting that year. I was coming off the bench, and Aaron Bisson had gotten hurt. And so a coach put me in the starting lineup that weekend, and we squeaked out one. Then we went over to towards the end of the season, and we're the number one seed was up for grabs in the bye at the tournament.
Right.
And we just went over and got crushed that first game. 26 points, something like that. Carlos had a couple of real big dunks and ran us out of the gym. And then the next night was your senior night, and I believe the game went to overtime.
It very well could have, and I'm not really sure of the circumstances. I just remembered in playing against you guys that year that we had a really difficult time matching up with Ryan and then the other players, the pieces around him in terms of And the way you structured your offense that year, it was very difficult to match up, and with the personnel we had, and we just didn't match up well, and it created a lot of problems for us, and we we struggled, and ended up losing that game, as I recall.
Yeah, I mean, I remember I was on the bench. I think Hirai and Bisson had kind of gotten to a groove there in the fourth quarter, and coach just rode them out throughout the game, and I remember Carl Bogren and Ryan Lane kind of trading shots towards the end of the game, and I remember Ryan hitting a shot at the end. I feel like it was overtime at the end of the game, and I think I was out to half court hugging Ryan before the clock had gone off, so there's probably a technical foul that could have been called if we went back and looked at the tape, but that was fun. And then, of course, that year we went down, and I think the only time in Region 5 basketball tournament history where a team went and played one game and they were done, we went and Ketchikan played a box and won on Ryan, and we didn't really know what we were doing, and we lost and didn't get the chance to match up with you that we'd been looking forward to all year. And anyways, you went on, you won the tournament and went on to win the state tournament that year, your first state championship as a coach. And I remember distinctly you overflew Juneau on your way back and ended up at the SJ gym on that Sunday after the game. And I just remember you guys being there after you had won state.
Well, I believe Coach Bisson, wanted to go one more time because we ended up two and two against each other. We wanted to, do it for all the marbles,
The tiebreaker, yeah.
And so he came to the hotel room we were in later and suggested that. And the only thing I wanted to do was sleep because I hadn't gotten any sleep at all that night.
I'm
and then
sure.
we overfly Juneau and end up here, and I just wanted to go to sleep.
But I remember reading a quote in the either the Empire or the Anchorage Daily News where you had something said something to the effect of, you know, this state's championship is as much about the kids that I coached before this as it is about the kids that are here now. And, you know, you were very humble in saying that, you know, your coaching had finally caught up to the players you had. And so I wanted to talk to Coach Casperson about what the experience playing for Coach Houston was like. You had kind of come up. He was kind of a newer head coach, only been around a couple of years when you came to the program. And what was that? What was your expectation as you walked in there?
With our family, you know, longtime Juneau family, you know, I'd certainly been around the games and having my older brothers play and everything for Coach Hamey and seeing Coach Houston at that time. I knew who he was and through camps and all that. You know, the freshman year, I ended up playing on the JVs and the C team. And I had three other guys in my class that made the varsity that year. And so there was a lot of motivation for me to try to move up to varsity the sophomore year, and that and the C team JV shorts were the holdovers from the old days, the short shorts.
They were very cheeky.
Yeah, and boy, not that the varsity shorts were much better nowadays considering, but they were a lot better than what we had back then, so that was motivation
seeing,
too.
Yeah,
so.
seeing Carlos in those this first year, that was a sight. Yeah.
So, you know, it was – what I knew and what my expectation was, especially with the guys who were ahead of me, was to work extremely hard and to compete. That's how practices were structured. You know, yeah, those were your teammates in practice, but it was still your competition because you were fighting for an opportunity to play. You know, and we'd get together outside of season and spend some time working and you know, on our games, and we went to camp, you know, in Juneau there. And I think that had a lot to do with our development and our camaraderie as a group. You know, there was four of us as seniors, and we certainly knew that we had graduated a lot of talent from the year before. And I believe someone had pointed out we had graduated like 90% of our scoring. The only guy who really had any impact on the offense or got any, you know, big minutes was Josh Lockhart, who was probably an all-region guard at that point, I'd imagine. And so we knew we weren't going to do it alone. And as seniors, we made a real big push to get the younger guys involved early, the Bogrens, the Dibdals. You know, Joe Kemp was a big part of what we did our senior year. And, you know, we ended up having quite a lot of success in our senior year and had to build up to it. But if memory serves, I think we only lost two games that year.
Regular season, I think, yeah.
And, well, I think we finished at 25-2.
Is that what it was?
And we lost to East at East by 7, and then we lost to Bartlett in the first round of the state tournament by 4.
And this is when Chuck was still coaching at East.
Yeah, right?
Yeah,
yeah. And Phil Jordan was at Bartlett, I believe.
He was at Bartlett, yeah.
And they eventually Australians. Won the state title against East on a last second inbounds play, as I recall.
Yeah, yeah. So, and that, you know, there, I was in college when they won the state championship, and I remember reading that quote, and I took some pride in that. You know, that meant a lot to us.
Absolutely.
And you know, we didn't have the Facey page or the Twitter birds or whatever back then. So we got on the phone, we called each other, you know, the seniors from that group that were all off freshman year of college, and we had talked to each other about that, and that meant a lot to us. You know, and I was in touch with some of those guys, Joe Kemp in particular, and he said he really believed that they had some personality issues on that team. And what they kind of did was they did look at our group and how we were able to set any differences aside and work towards a common goal. And he said that helped them going into regions and then going into state. He felt like they were either going to lose the regions or win the state with that group they had. And you know, we know how that story played out, but you know, and that it's all part of being invested in a program. You know, you look back, and I felt good for those guys. Of course, we wanted to win it our senior year too, but I felt good for those guys, and I took some pride in their success.
Yeah, it was a strange feeling for me. I remember being at the gym that day when you guys overflew and you came in, and some of your guys came in and shot baskets that Sunday. And I remember just, you know, it was kind of like, you know, I had finished my senior year and the revelry was over, and I remember being really excited for you guys, and you know, proud of the fact that a Southeast team had gone up and won the state championship that year. And, you know, I'm sure it's kind of in a different way, similar to what you're feeling with those guys as you mentored some of those guys. And I look back at that era of basketball now, and of course, since I was involved in it, it seems like the pinnacle of basketball in Southeast Alaska.
That's but, right.
You know, you know, it seems like a renaissance era as I look back on it. Yeah. And man, those teams that did come through Juneau Douglas, you know, through those years, that, you know, 95 with those guys, that was such a tough squad. And then you guys there, and, you know, we were super young that year. I think we had one senior. I remember just, you know, feeling like the coaches had given up on us, but they were just trying to figure out what to do that year, my junior year, because we had one senior, and I remember we came over and played that four corners, and
that Craig Bisson,
we won the tip, yeah. And Craig Bisson called out one shot, you know, right off the bat in the first quarter, and it was like 4-2 after 8 minutes. But yeah, I mean, well, obviously, your one player was trying to.
He was, in all honesty, he was a McDonald's All-American, right? So that right, you had exactly. a very talented senior that year. So
yeah, there you go.
You know, and you had mentioned the one win, and that got me thinking. We actually, that your first 4 years, Coach, you were 31-1 in region. The only loss was on a last-second buzzer beater in Ketchikan our freshman year.
From just over half court.
Yeah, and then after that, we didn't lose a game. Or
I remember that,
And Ketchikan had good teams then. Oh, yeah. David Mitchell, Luke LeBeau, and Isaac Isaiah, and those guys during our time.
All three teams during that era were really competitive, and you know, quite frankly, some of the best competition we had was in Southeast,
definitely.
You know, and you, because you played four times minimum against each other prior to tournament. Yeah, I mean, you really got to know the other team and tendencies and that type of thing, and it made for some serious rivalries, that's for sure.
Yeah, it was. Great memories. Obviously, I'm back in the thick of activities. Coach Casperson's coaching. Yeah. You know, I think it's something that stuck with us, obviously, that we've continued to be passionate about here in this region. You know, during that time span when you won that state championship, it seemed like, you know, as I look back and recall our games against you that year, obviously the biggest name to ever come out of Juneau Douglas basketball, Carlos Boozer, who's...
Oh, I thought you were going to say me.
Yeah, the second biggest, of course, is Coach Casperson.
Right, yeah.
But he's now playing professionally in the NBA, and he was a sophomore that year when you won the state championship. And as I look back at our games, I don't remember him being a dominant force. I remember looking back at the stat sheets, and he had 20 or 30 points, but I don't remember ever feeling like he had just kind of taken over a game.
He was, 6'6", 6'7" that year, or maybe he was at the beginning, and at the end he was 6'8" or 6'9". But he, you know, with a lot of young, big kids and his all of his coordination and definitely his strength hadn't caught up to him yet, and it really didn't hit until he was a junior. And of course, on into his senior year that his athleticism and strength caught up to him. And but he was you could see the potential was there for him to develop and just be a tremendous player. And one of the things in Robert's senior year is because he was like 6'5" then, and he could really jump and in practice he dunked the ball all the time, and I used to always get on him in practice when he dunked the ball because he hadn't done one in a game, so it wasn't really real.
Right.
And I'd say game shots. You know, if you're going to dunk, you know, you're going to dunk it in practice. You got to dunk it in the game. It wasn't until his service tournament, or the tip-off tournament up there that he, against Lathrop, that he finally got his first game dunk. And he told me later, he said that I couldn't use that line on him anymore. And I said, you're very right. And I thought, why did you wait so long? Yeah. You know, when I first saw him in eighth grade, you could see he had potential. He was 6'1", and he was all arms and legs and huge hands, huge feet. Yeah, he was destined to grow.
Well,
I didn't know he was going to be 6'8", 6'9", and 260, but, you know.
His freshman year, during our senior year, that was we could see that, and we knew, and one of the things that was, he was like 6'5", 175, but he played. He was the first big off the bench, and if memory serves, I think he might have even led us in rebounding that year. If not, he was a close second.
He and Joe Kemp really, you know, battled each other for that.
Right, and so one of the things we really had to try to talk to him about as seniors was like, look, Coach Houston has you on the floor. You're not a freshman. You're a varsity player. You know, you're out there because you're good enough. So play with confidence, and we believe in you. And, you know, and it was fun. I used to get in trouble in practice too. I'd always try to throw him lobs in practice. Coach didn't like that.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Too flashy.
Yeah. Well,
yeah. Bounce pass.
Yeah, yeah. I was probably not impressed when the flashy went out of bounds.
Well, yeah. My memory of him that year, my senior year, is that he played outside a lot. And, you know, I don't know whether it was intentional by you to help him kind of. You saw the fact that he was going to be playing at a higher level, and you wanted to develop his perimeter skills, or if
I didn't want to pigeonhole him, but yet the option was there, and we had Joe Kemp inside, who was 6'5" and 220 at the time, and you know, if he had an ounce of fat on him, I couldn't find it, but so we primarily played him back to the basket and let Carlos stay on the perimeter a little bit more, but we would change that around too with back screens and stuff, and change who was in the post and give him that option. But, you know, I didn't want to pigeonhole him into just being a low post player, but we had to kind of remind him as time went on that he's going to make his money down in the paint.
Yeah, and he's doing that
he's
now.
He's done that, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I always thought that, you know, that year, 1997, when you won the first state championship, that, you know, he kind of came into his own during that state run. And
oh, he did.
He had kind of been the difference. You know, he didn't really dominate throughout the region, I felt like, but he was kind of the thing that got you over the hump at the state tournament that year, and I don't know why I thought that, but
well, he he had a tremendous game against the East, and
was that the championship game?
That was the semifinal.
Okay,
and it came down to the end, and we got a breakaway, and he was going down on their best player who had four fouls, and then he made a move, and surprisingly, Robert, he went left.
Yeah, right,
which he favors to do.
Never does that. Yeah.
And they called a block, and he made the left-handed scoop shot, and pretty much decided the game at that point. And then we went on and played Colony, who had beaten us earlier, and ended up beating them for the championship of the state that year.
And was that year they had that group of kids who had come up together and they had big hopes and designs on their futures?
That was when they had first opened Colony, and they had a group that had gone kind of all the way through. And
Really standout guard. I can't remember his name.
Eli Wilson.
Yeah, Eli Wilson. Yeah. Yeah, and he was the player of the year that year, I believe. And we ended up beating them in the final, and they had lost one kid, a 6'10 kid, for disciplinary reasons earlier in the year, and that kind of had a bearing on where they were at and why we were fortunate enough to win the ball game. They're still a tremendous ball club, but they just didn't have the same type of depth they had had before with him, and we were playing on top of our game by that point, and the guys believed in each other finally, and that was one of the struggles we had during the course of the year. I felt our chemistry wasn't what it had been in Robert's senior year and that type of thing, and it was gratifying from a coaching standpoint that they finally saw the picture. And I think to that point in my career, we had lost more games in a season that year than we had in all the other previous seasons. Six games or something, and we'd never lost more than four before, and it was an eye-opener for them, and yet at the end of the season, they did get it together, and, you know, I guess I look back, and I guess I'm really glad we didn't have to play you guys again, because I'm not smart enough to use a box and one on Ryan Lane. You know?
Well, that would constitute as a zone, right?
And that's not in the
vernacular. So
we actually did introduce the zone that year. Thanks. Yeah, I don't know where it came from, but...
Yeah.
How many possessions was that?
Three possessions. Yeah, as soon as they scored, we got out of
that. I think
maybe
the biggest compliment I've ever heard is that Coach Houston had possibly devised his own defense to use against Sitka in a possibly regional matchup.
There you go.
Yeah. Well, I had to do something. I had to give guys some hope in it, and that we're going to do something different rather than just do the same old thing. And I don't know if that had any bearing on it or not. And I've never really talked to the kids about it, but they. They played with a serious sense of purpose when we went into tournament. And then when you guys got upset, we felt that we had, like Joe Kemp said, we're either going to lose in regionals or we're going to go all the way.
Right.
And they had that mindset, and obviously it worked out.
Well, Mike, you had mentioned it seemed like Carlos maybe kind of turned it on towards the latter half of the year. Something that a lot of people don't realize about Carlos, he played – and just how the seasons were aligned back then, Carlos played half his freshman year as a 13-year-old.
Yeah.
You know, and he turned 14 in November or something.
November 20th is his birthday.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, the season you know, he was, in October.
He was young, and it's hard for people to think that when they look at a man-child on the floor.
Right.
But he could have had another year in high school.
Yeah. Yeah, Coach, and obviously Carlos went on to play at Duke and win a national championship, and he's now playing in the league. But you had a chance to follow his career and enjoy some of those moments with him. Did you get a chance to experience some games at Cameron, and what was that kind of like for you?
I did go back there with him a couple times. Robert's brother Kevin, his assistant now, was my assistant at the time, and we went back there for a clinic. And had because he was there playing, we had the opportunity to go into the locker room and be with the team and hang around the team a little bit. And I also got to go there when he was being recruited by Duke. And after one of the practices, they go back in there, and they had Elton Brand and all these guys that they had that were going to be future professionals. And Coach K asked me, you know, well, what do you think of practice? And I was kind of dumbfounded. I said, well, it looked pretty good to me, Coach. I mean,
well, Coach, let me tell you what I think you should do.
Yeah, I think you ought to do this. No, I don't think I'd be saying that to Coach K, but it was a tremendous opportunity. Got to go to the Final Four when they did win it that year in 2001 back in Minneapolis, and that was a tremendous opportunity as well. And just seeing that and all the hoopla around that, and yet spending some time with Los was cool too at the time, because he was the same kid. You know, just playing at a higher level, higher level.
Yeah.
Well, it's been fun to follow him, and obviously it's nice to, you know, it's nice to have a claim to fame that you played against a guy that's playing professionally. I actually was digging through an old scrapbook last week. I had moved a bunch of boxes up for my parents and found this picture of me from the Empire that, you know, I was just this scrawny 5'7", 135-pound guard, and Carlos was putting on a trap at half court, and he just looked like a matador just about to swallow me up. So it was fun to see. We got just about a minute and a half left here, and Robert, I just want to ask you kind of what it's like. You've taken over as head coach now, and you get to have Coach Houston around. He's still, you know, a big supporter of you, and you know, what's kind of that meant to you in your coaching career, and you know, how do you use him over there?
Yeah, no, it's meant the world to me to have someone that I respect and to have all that knowledge and experience still willing to come around and help out. You know, Coach Houston lives really close to the gym. He can look down and see when the lights are on from his house. And every now and then he finds his way down there when we're having practice. And, you know, he does our radio during the games. And so he's got a crow's eye view or whatever from the nest up there and bird's eye view. And he and I talk after games and stuff. And it's I'd be foolish not to, you know, to use his knowledge and expertise. And doesn't mean I do everything he says, but – you know, it's
he tells you about it if you don't.
Oh yeah, yeah. I can only imagine what he says on the radio when I'm down there patrolling the sidelines.
It's going good, Coach. I haven't seen orange this week.
Okay. Yeah. A zone. Yeah. So.
Well, it's always fun seeing you at the events still, Coach, and having you around, and I'm glad that you're still involved. Thank you guys for coming in. I really appreciate it. It's been fun. I feel like we could talk for several more hours, but we'll do that.
Thank you.
The next time
us.
Tournament's in here.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Next time. Yeah, hopefully, God willing, I'll be back.
So this has been Sitka Sports on KCAW Sitka.